Hey, and welcome back to Tell Samira. So today I'm talking about the narcissistic female romantic partner that is the princess slash masculine energy. In my experience, I've seen two types of narcissists in relationships with men. It's either the one that's the princess, meaning she's the one who wants to be doted on the most, and she comes off with really a lot of feminine energy, might like to wear really girly colors and be very really overly flirtatious, you know, even how she relates to maybe even other women. You know, she's the girly girl. And she has this fantasy of being swept off her feet and being taken care of by a man. You know, she maybe just wants to stay at home and do nothing and just have this man serve her and bring her the money. Now, I'm not saying anything's wrong with a traditional relationship where a woman stays at home and the man provides fully. If you find that, that's great. But this is just happens to be one of the characteristics I noticed with the princess. Also, with the masculine narcissistic female in a relationship, she's more of the kind that you would look at like some type of domineering man. You know, she's very dominant in how she reacts and behaves with other women, with how she relates to men. You know, she might try to find men that's younger than her so she could be in full control, you know, or men that's unemployed, somebody that's really not going to challenge her much. But she is very manly in her presentation with the world. What I've noticed, though, with both of the princess and with the masculine energy, they both are strategic in how they select their victims. So, you know, even though this is deemed a mental illness, these people, they know what they're doing. So, for instance, like my mom didn't tell me anything about relationships except one thing. She said, Samira, when you get in a relationship with a man, the first thing you have to do is let him know who's in control from the start. You let him know who the boss is. Like my mother in relationships was very that masculine energy. So with both of these types, they're looking to see, who's going to dote on me the most? Who's going to, you know, sing my praises? Who's going to listen attentively to all my stories, not interrupt me much because I really don't care about what he has to say? Who's going to let me do all the control? That's a big thing with them. They want to be in control, but how they execute that control is different. The female, the princess, is more maybe whiny, more seductive when she's wanting thing, and the one that's masculine is just sort of like, hey, do this, wear that, go there, where you, you know, they're just very really in your face and direct, you know, very aggressive with the way that they treat their man. So again, that's a selection process. With both of them, you're going to notice that honeymoon phase. You know, this narcissist is they like to come off as very maybe assertive, very confident. They may flirt with you across the bar. You may see them winking at you, playing in their hair. You know, they may come over to you and get your phone number, introduce themselves. They may seem to be the life of the party. Maybe they can dance, or if they're not into dancing, they're telling you these stories, and they just have this larger-than-life personality. They've already observed you across the room, and they want to see if you are going to give them maybe what it is they're looking for. You know, so you're really caught in this, like, wow, this is a very outgoing person. They're very confident. And especially if you're very introverted, this may be attractive. Like, wow, you know, you as an introvert may think, I've always wanted to be more outgoing, the life of the party. Now I have this person and they're exciting. And now my life can be more exciting. And now I can get out and be more in the know, you know, with this person who just seems to have conquered the world and just great, everything maybe that you feel that you're missing in your life, you know. So they may really pretend to care about you and your needs during this time, because what I like to say is that the devil will never come to you with the horns and the red eyes and you know, this person is going to come to you very nice and caring. Why? Because if you knew this person was manipulative, very full of themselves with their ego, and may try to destroy you later, you're going to say, heck no, get away from me, and you're going to run. Like, get out of there, you know? But they have to come to you in this nice and seductive way, you know, to first to get you to put down your guard and to begin to trust them, because that's how it goes, you know. First the nice, and then comes that nasty. So you may also have hear stories of victimhood. This person is telling you how, oh, people have taken advantage of them so much, and they're always so giving and trying to help cultivate their mate, trying to get them to go to higher levels. And when that mate got to the higher levels, they just left the narcissist, and you know, nothing good is coming. And you may just be so caught up into this person's drama and, you know, vibrant and larger than life energy, you're not noticing all these stories that the comments denominator is this person is a victim. And as I talked before, as Robert Greene said, the infector is that person who can come along with all these sob stories and make you want to feel sorry for that individual and come in to be the rescuer, and you just get totally destroyed in the end. It's like when the avoid the unlucky, avoid those that's always, they're always the victim and nothing is going right for them. Of course, like Robert Greene said, there are some people who honestly need a hand up. You know, we're not talking about avoiding those, but those that's coming around with always the same sob story, you got to get away from them. That's a red flag that some of people, and if you're a man with this woman, you ignore that. But this is something that you can think about in the future so you don't attract this type of person anymore. So another common thing with that princess and the masculine is that need for control. If you all have kids together, you may notice that she's the type of person who wants to have the say-so with the kids. She may want to abuse one of the kids, play the kids against each other, making one think one is better than the other one's a failure. And she wants a man who's going to go along with that. If he does say something to her, she can just give him a look, you know, or she'll say something about him or make him just shut up, and then he goes and runs in the corner because she's chosen a man that's not going to have much of a backbone. So he's not going to really have much of a say about the kids or anything in the home regarding who's doing the chores, the running of the house, the finances. Even if she's the princess and staying at home, she has to be in charge, telling you what to buy, what to do, how to spend your money. You may even notice she's telling you where to go, you know, giving you a curfew. You know, I've noticed with my mom, with me and the few that lived in our house, like they had to be back in at a certain time. It was her house, you know, and that's what I've noticed with the masculine. They want to move a man inside their house so they can easily kick him out, you know, if he does something wrong, you know. And so it's always their way or the highway, and you're going to experience wrath if you don't do what they do. Now, during this phase, you may be wondering, especially if it's a newer relationship, like what happened? You know, when I first met this individual, it was all great. You know, they were the life of the party, telling me how great I was as a man, and they admired me. They've not met anyone like me. So now you're like, wow, it seems like they're discarding me in a bit. They're really nasty to me. I feel like I'm walking on eggshells. And you may hang on in that relationship. Let's say if you're dating, you don't have any kids. You may hang on because you're waiting for that good day to come back. You know, you're always living for that instead of living in the here and now. Living in the here and now is not thinking about how a person was to you in the past or how it could be in the future. The here and now is saying, how is this person treating you now? Well, how do you feel around this person now? And you to dig into your power and to come back in a stronger way, you have to say, if this isn't working now, then I must leave. I must do better and see what I did to hold on to a person like this so I don't get that type of relationship in the future. But it's not always that easy, especially if you are married to this person, if you have kids. I do realize that. Both with the princess and the masculine energy, this person is never satisfied. If you give them roses, 10, 12 roses, they'll ask you, why wasn't it 24? You know, you were probably the most handsome person in the world when you first met them. Oh, they really loved your physique. But now all of a sudden, they're telling you that, you know, know, you're getting flab on your stomach, or your hairline is receding, or why is your earlobe so big? You know, there's going to be something about you. Oh, why do you wear this type of shoe? You really need to have that type of shoe, you know, or they're telling you, oh, where to go, or you could be always something you can do better. The narcissistic female I used to live with, she would tell me stories of when she had different boyfriends staying with her, that they would get upset with her. But according to her, she was only trying to help them. She would tell them that their resume wasn't good enough, and no one was going to hire them. So she wanted to have them rearrange the resume according to her way. Or she would say she doesn't know why they aren't more ambitious and they should be going after higher jobs. She even told me about an engineer who apparently his hours had been cut back drastically, and she couldn't even hold down a job as a cell phone seller in a kiosk in a mall. But she had the unmitigated gall to start telling him about how he should be more ambitious in his job. So yeah, as I was saying, she was telling this individual how he could have just been better as a man, even though she didn't have the same skill set that he had. So you may find that with this narcissistic female that you start off with having high thoughts of yourself and thinking good of yourself as a man. But when she's done with you, you know, you'll start to doubt yourself. Am I a good provider? Am I a good father? Am I really good at my career? Because she's constantly picking with you. So now you really don't know, you know, how you feel about yourself. And that's the place that she wants you to be, because she wants you to be doubtful, you know, because if you're doubtful of yourself, she's sure that you're going to stay with her and that you're not going to have enough confidence to go with someone else. So that way you can stay under her control. Also with both the princess and the masculine narcissist female in a relationship, she's very lazy. So she expects you to do everything, to work, then come home to clean. You know, she's expecting to be taken care of, you giving her all the massages, and you're doing everything, you know. And then once you start doing all these things, you, like I said, she's never satisfied. So you're cutting the grass, as she asks, but then you notice she comes out and she critiques it. Why didn't you cut it this way? Or why didn't you cut the weeds down this way? Or she's lazy and not going to help you with the cleaning the garage. So she'll ask you, well, why didn't you set up your tools this way in the garage? And why didn't you spray down the garage? There's always something, you know. She's going to point and tell you how to do things, but she's going to sit on the couch or text you from the house telling you how to cut the grass, because she can't be busy. I mean, she can't, you know, be bothered to come out there and try to help with the process. You'll notice too with these women that they're well dressed, no matter what size they are, even if they're not the prettiest. You know, they are well dressed. They like to do things to bring attention to themselves. So that's one thing that you will notice. They also, as I talked about briefly, appear confident. You know, they may seem like they're, you may hear them talking in ways that, and it may be obvious and not so obvious, but that they're smarter than others. Somehow they're better than others. For instance, if you're in a hotel and someone comes to clean, and then you may hear her telling stories of, you know, I used to clean hotels myself years ago, and I fluffed the pillows this way, and I always left a mint on the bed, and I always made sure the towels were fluffy and hung them this way. Anybody who's doing this job should know it. You know, and you may not think anything of it at the time, but you notice that really what the underlying thing is that she's saying that she's better than that maid. Or you'll hear her say things about other people in relationships, about maybe some other wife, someone else's wife. Oh, she shouldn't do things like this, or she shouldn't say that to her husband. She should say it this way. Or talk about someone with their kids. Oh, their kids don't dress well enough, or oh, her kid is ugly, or oh, her kids aren't so smart as our kids. Or, you know, it's always comparing. You'll notice that she may even compare you to other to other men, saying that, Judy's husband, he gives her this and he takes her there. And I just don't know why you don't take me there, or you don't do these things for me, or I just don't know why you can't hold down a certain job the way that Judy's husband holds down a job. So you're always feeling bad about yourself, always feeling that you're just like never enough. Or even the one that's the masculine one, even though she may tell you things like, I just don't know why you don't, you don't do more, or why you don't, she's finding ways to criticize you too, even though she's the one that's mostly in control. She's going to let you know that and remind you of that every chance she gets. The reason that the narcissist is so overly dramatic, appears overly confident is because they're hiding a fragile ego. You know, anytime you see someone doing something over the top, it's because usually the opposite of that is true for them. So sometimes, as I've said before, you see these people going, I keep it 100. I tell the truth all the time. I keep it 100. Truth is, they keep it zero. They're trying to get you to buy into that. Or somebody that's always talking about, I speak my mind. I this. The truth is they probably have some insecurity inside and feel, that they've been hurt before. And so now it is, they have a fear of not speaking their mind. So they have to constantly tell you this. Or this woman may constantly tell you like how beautiful she is and how good looking she is. And that's because she doesn't really feel so good about herself, or just how smart she is and how people should, they should know how to do this, and common sense would tell them, there's an issue there. She's not really feeling too good about herself. So a lot of times you may notice as a man in relationship with her, she's projecting the things that she really feels about herself, her own insecurities. She may say that you have those insecurities. For instance, she may treat you like crap and call you names, or get really outrageous and maybe throwing dishes around the house, trying to cut you, chasing you after you with a knife, doing something outrageous. And she may tell you, you're so angry, you're so violent, I don't know why I have to walk on eggshells around you. But really, you may not even be the angry person. You may not be the violent person. It's her. She's also, both of these type of narcissists, the princess and the masculine, they're both entitled. They feel that you're with them. You're the husband, the boyfriend. You should be doing this and you should be doing that. I dare you for not doing it. And they want you sort of to be what I found to be mind readers. They don't really feel that they have to be bothered with telling you little peon in their eyes, what needs to be done. It's like you should know them enough and be able to read their mind to know what it is they want. Now, every relationship, there's a give and take, and everyone has expectations. But really, with this narcissist, they may not tell you all their expectations. They just sort of expect you to know. They may give you some hints or tell you a few things, but they just expect you to be a good servant, a good slave, and always know what it is that they need, and to anticipate those needs and get whatever done that needs to be done for them to make their life easier. You know, they're always looking for, as they used to call it back in the early 2000s, the Master P, the hookup, trying to get something for nothing. You know, they're always looking to see what it is they can get out of other people. You know, with this entitlement, you may notice with the princess, she may be more whining and nagging. Oh, you should do this. Oh, why won't you do this? Reminds me of Delilah in the Bible with Samson. She nagged that man so much. Oh, tell me, where do you get your powers? Oh, you're making a fool of me. Oh, the Philistines, they're laughing at me. You won't tell me how you got your power. How are you so strong? Samson. Oh, Samson, tell me. To the point that the man got so fed up, he said, look, the power is in my hair. And then she ended up getting the Philistines upon him. And she said, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. All the other times he got away because he had lied to her about his strength. But this time he told the truth, and the poor man's locks were cut off. That lets you know he was black. That's another story. But anyway, the poor man's locks were cut off. And then He lost his strength. He eventually was put in prison, got his eyes, eyes put out. He was a slave, but eventually his hair grew back and got his strength, okay? So sometimes you can come back from a narcissist. You may be not physically blinded, but you know, blinded about who you are, your worth as a person, you know, feeling guilty and shame that you chose such a person, you know, but hey, you have to accept, you know, that this person, you know, was out to get you and may have never loved you, and you were maybe in love, maybe in lust or whatever, but hey, this person can do some real damage. Also, that narcissist likes to control your emotions. They want to be in control of the whole house. If they're feeling bad, people, the other people in the household, especially if this is the husband they walk over or the kids that they don't like, you know, everybody has to feel the way they feel. The husband, you can come in having a great day from work or spending time with your friends. And for whatever reason, you know, she may not like that you came in with a smile. So she'll start picking with you, saying things that she knows to get under your skin. So that smile can turn into a frown, and now you're angry and, you know, walking around the house like matching her energy. But the trick to that is when she wants you to be angry, to act like you're unbothered, to stay happy, to stay smiling, to ignore the triggers. If she's telling you, oh, if you know that she knows that you pride yourself on being a good dad, she'll probably say, oh, you know, I read this study today that, you know, men aren't what they used to be and they're just not good dads anymore. I don't know. I just feel for those women because I can totally relate. You know, it's hard to be a woman with, you know, having a man even in your house, but you feel like you're really doing it all alone. And, you know, normally you would blow up. What do you mean? I provide for you all. I do this. I even come home and cook and clean because you don't want to do anything but sit on your fat butt and give orders. But, you know, you fall for this. But instead, you know, trying to just be like, didn't hear that story before. Interesting. And walk off and keep a poker face, that blank face, because they're looking, they're very good at watching your body language. They watch you to see how to poke at you. So they look, like if you get like this in your eyes, they notice that they're skilled at watching other people, you know, or if you tensed up like, oh my God, you know, they notice that. So try to remain calm. And, you know, it seems tough at first, but you have to work on it to practice keeping that poker face, making sure that your tone of voice tries to stay the same, because they can notice the tone of voice. Like if you're like, oh, I didn't see that article, they pick up on that. And then they still got you. They're getting that narcissistic supply, that negative energy, because they love it. They prey on it. So we can't give them that. And so continue to watch my videos for ways, you know, to learn how to deal with these people. I'm not done yet, but please like, if you like this video, subscribe, and also hit that notification bell. All right, so they'll even, a narcissistic female, she'll even sabotage you. You know, she wants to feel that in some way that she's better than you. You know, she doesn't want you to get out of line and think too high of yourself. So she may, you know, if she's angry with you, it may not be above her to come to your job and to try to curse at you, if she's especially, you know, the dominant kind, you know, curse at you in front of other people, or to say little snarky remarks in front of people. And she may say it in a way that's not so obvious, but you and her know that it's a dig. And then if you blow up, she got you. And then around your friends and family and co-workers, you're looking like the crazy man husband, but really she's been poking at you all the time, and she does it in such a way that other people don't know. So she does things to try to get under your skin. Also with the lies, she may tell other people just things that's just not true about you. And especially if you break up with her, you know, she'll say that you were the one that was a stalker. You were maybe abusive to the kids, somehow neglectful to them, to her. You made her feel bad about herself. You were constantly criticizing her as a woman. These are all things she was probably doing to you, but she'll tell your family, your friends why. It's a part of a smear campaign. Watch my video on my channel about this, how to survive a smear campaign. She'll do all these things because she wants to destroy you. She's a master at noticing what makes us tick, the things that we value. Because if you value something so much, you know, to the point that you'll do anything to protect that thing, she'll go after it. So it's like, I know he values being a good dad. So at the next family outing, I'll just start whispering to his mom and anybody who will listen to me, oh, I don't know what's wrong with him. He's not taking care of the house as he used to. You know, because she knows you're going rage once you hear back, because you probably will hear, especially if it's your family, you know, but there's ways, you know, to get around that. You have, like I said, watch the video on learning how not to be so triggered by these mirror campaigns. Also, you'll notice that they are jealous, you know. They may try to get you to be jealous of them, telling you stories about how other men are flirting with them and how people, if they went out with their girls, how men can stop by sending them drinks over at the bar. You know, different things just to, you know, remind you of how great they are, get you to buy into how wonderful they are. They might also even flirt with people in front of you because they like to be very sexual. What I've known with every narcissistic female, if relationships, is that they like to talk about sex a lot. You know, they like to talk about giving, you know, the one I stayed with, she would like to tell stories about giving oral sex to a masseuse that she didn't know who was massaging her, you know, or giving oral sex to a landlord for rent. You know, they like to tell these larger than life stories about their sexual lives, you know, again, as a way to bring attention to them. And they may even say that kind of stuff in front of their, you know, in front of their spouse, you know, just to get a rise out of the spouse. So they court the drama and the tension at every cost. One thing my mother told me about my father, I wasn't there. She claims that he didn't want her to go around his friends because he said that she would make his friends look dumb because she was so smart. Now, you know, of course, that's the narcissist wanting to look better than other people, to be smarter and somehow superior to others. But this is what she claims, he says, but narcissism, including my narcissistic mother, is prone to lies. So who knows, that could have just been something she created in her head, you know, just so I could feel good about how smart she was, you know. They seem to be nicer to strangers, you know. She may curse at you in the house, say nasty things to you, you know. Sometimes she may be nice, and you know, that may be the reason you stay. She's hot, then she's cold. Hot and cold, you don't know what you're gonna get, and you're always waiting to go back to that honeymoon phase. But honey, that phase is dead. That's why I said the here and now. How are you being treated now? You know, They count on you to stay. But you see them acting so nice and courteous to other people, and you're like, wow, she doesn't treat me this way, you know, except maybe once a month. But then you're like, what is that about? And sometimes they'll do it just to show you in front of others, if you behave and allow me to control you and stay under my foot, this is how you could be treated, like I'm treating this nice person over here. This is how I imagine they talk to themselves. So you'll even notice that even if you happen to leave these people, they will shame you. And even if you stay with them, for instance, one instance of shaming, the narcissistic friend I live with, she told me about this guy she used to date, and she claims that she left him, saying that, you know, she wasn't in love with him, although she had some love with him, telling me stories of how every time he had a bowel movement, he would leave boo-boo on the back of the seat of the toilet, and how she would constantly go to him and ask him to clean it, and he would get so upset with her, and she couldn't understand why, and this was a constant thing. He kept leaving boo-boo on the toilet, and she would have to clean it, and he would get so upset. You know, this is a very embarrassing story, but this is something that she's telling me about someone she claimed who was so great to her, but she had to leave him. And then she talked about how small his penis was and that she couldn't stay with him because his penis was just that small. And she kept just telling these stories over and over for different occasions out of nowhere about this man, you know. Or she'll, you know, there'll be stories that that they'll say about their partners or their exes. Things like, she talked about this one guy saying, oh, she couldn't understand why he kept, you know, she liked him. They were never a couple, but they were intimate and they would hang out, and she kept on texting him saying she wishes it they could rekindle it. And he started texting her saying, you know, fat girls give head because they're hungry. And I was like, oh, that's so horrible and horrible. But when I noticed how she treated me as a friend, I started seeing that that was similar to some of the stories she would tell me about that man. And so she was actually stalking him at the end when he decided he didn't want anymore. That was the engineer, you know, he got tired of her. And so she started to stalking. So that brings me to the conclusion. Sometimes with these women, they will dismiss you, or they'll get rid of you, and they probably won't care about the relationship because the love was never there. Be careful of the stalking, and they may accuse you of stalking. If it's kids and there's a divorce or you're living there, then you might need a mediator. You might need restraining orders. Keep the texts and voicemails that they give you, because you might need to show that to the lawyer in the future. Put things in writing with them regarding the terms of who's going to have the kids on what this day and that day, if you decide that you can't stay in this type of relationship. The masculine woman will throw you out of her house and put you on the street if you upset her so much. She'll get rid of you. I talked about the smear campaign. They'll tell lies on you. Anyone who will listen, they'll tell just how evil and crazy you are. What you have to do as the man is to... So what you have to do as a man is to accept that you stayed in a relationship probably longer than you should have, that you ignored the smoke, the red flags that came with this, hoping for good days to return, that honeymoon phase, even though it was well gone. Also having to accept that they are who they are, and that they, accept that these people, usually don't change, and that if you're hoping for things to get better with these people, 9 out of 10, it's not going to get better. They are who they are. Also letting go of how you've been taught about forgiveness. One reason people stay in relationships is because, and I blame the church for this, is how they mistaught forgiveness. It's making you think that even without apologies, you need to stay with people, and that people keep doing the same thing to you over and over, and you just need to keep, staying for it sometimes, you know. But some people will tell you, you know, you can forgive, but you don't have to keep up with that, you know, keep going for bad behavior. So you can go with that too. You know, you don't have to accept it just because someone, started treating you bad, then for a minute they start to treat you good, and that pattern keeps going on and on. You need to understand that that's who that person is. It's not going to be just basically good days. It's not a healthy relationship. This is who that person is. You know, in the beginning they pretended to be nice. That was only a front. They are that dark person, that person that's trying to destroy you. That's who they are, and you have to accept that. You have to let your no mean no, because they like to go after people that they can control. So having boundaries, if you're saying you're going to do something, do it. If you're saying you're not, don't do it. And don't be so quick to allow other people to change your mind. And you have to know what you want out of relationships. What are deal breakers? You know, go for what it is you want, because the narcissist know what it is they want. The narcissist, the roommate, she would date online and she would put the phone on speaker so I could hear her talking to people. She would vet them in the beginning, asking things like, do you know what a princess is? They would usually say, what do you mean? She would say, you know, treating a woman like a lady, texting me just to say hi and good morning, you're thinking of me, text me at night to say good night, bringing me flowers, taking care of my bills, if I need like a tire fix, you'll fix it, you know, taking care. Some of them would laugh and call her delusional, and some of them would go for it. But the thing was, she had a plan, and she would cut the ones out who would not fit her needs. So you could take a lesson from that, is knowing what you want and sticking by that, but in a healthy fashion, hopefully. If you grew up with a narcissistic mother, a narcissistic parent, or substance abuse parents or caretakers, you're more likely to attract a narcissist because you've probably been groomed for the dysfunction where you stay in relationships and even maybe jobs and things just too long, where other people say, wow, this is bad, I got to go. But something about you, once you see a glimmer of hope, you may decide that, oh no, I'm going to stay and it's going to get better. But the cycle keeps happening and you don't know how to say, this is toxic, it's unhealthy, and I love myself enough that I need to go. Also, you might have a tendency to rescue. You know, the princess is that damsel in distress, and you may have a thing for rescuing people, you know, trying to figure out where that thing is in you that feels that you need to be a rescuer. It's okay to want to provide for a woman, to take care of your family, but the thing where you feel you need to rescue and fall for sob stories, that's the problem right there. Also, if you're younger than the woman, understanding that sometimes an older woman may come to you because she wants to control you. You know, she feels that maybe you don't really know much about life and that you'll allow her to just be the dominant one in the relationship while you're the more the servant or subservient one in a relationship. So the way to get around that is to know that that could be a possibility. Not always, but to always, you know, I wouldn't suggest a man moving in with a woman. That's my thoughts on it, is to have your own house. You know, if you want a family, to bring a family into your own house, or you both get a new place together where you both can feel like you're coming in a new situation and not one, not having this unbalanced type of dynamic in your relationship. But yeah, having your own car, having a place to live, having your own money, not having to accept money from someone else. Because when you put yourself in someone else's house under their rules, you become their subject sometimes. And then especially, you don't have a car, you don't have a money, then this type of narcissistic woman is going to thrive in that relationship because she knows basically you don't have a pot to piss in or a window to throw it out. So you're going to be underneath her thumb. So that is that. And again, this is the narcissistic female, romantic partner, the princess, and masculine energy. Thank you for watching. Bye. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and hit the notification bell.